Welcome to How to Create an Arrangement from a Lead Sheet. I'm Maria Bastos, or MK Fee.
I'm Jess, Musical Moose.
Yeah.
Glad you guys are here.
Yeah, welcome. This has been quite an event so far. We've been really impressed with how wonderful and organized and all the amazing content. And so thank you all for being here. Thank you all for spending the time with us in the chat. See a lot of friendly faces in there, or handles, I guess I should say.
But, yeah,
so today we're going to tell you a little bit about what lead sheets are and how you can use them to make an arrangement. A lot of times we end up compressing arrangements into lead sheets, but we're going to try to do the opposite today. So a little bit.
And it's going to involve audience participation. We'll just put that out there right now.
Mm-hmm. And you can ask some questions throughout. We may or may not get to all of them during the actual panel. We'll have more formal questions at the end, but feel free to sprinkle in your questions if you have them. But here's some background on us if you want to go, Jess.
Yeah, sure. So I am a real life music teacher, like it says, and that's why I've got what I've got behind me. I direct middle and high school band, and I'm a saxophone player. And Maria and I are... we've worked on VG lead sheets together, and we have played in groups together.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Hi. So I'm Maria. I'm a nurse practitioner by day. I work in women's health, and I love my job, but I use music as a hobby and just kind of an escape from the seriousness of my job sometimes. So I've been playing violin since I was 7. I sing off and on, not in any kind of official capacity, but just for fun. I like to cook. And it was really important for me to do this panel personally because Jess and I have done an arrangement together a few years ago, and we're going to talk a lot about that today. And as an amateur musician, it was kind of hard for me to even get the courage to attempt it. So I know there's a lot of people out there who want to get into arranging who haven't done it before. And if I can do it, you can, because my skill in that regard is, you know, was non-existent. And we just kind of jumped into it because that's the only way to do it is just to try it. So I'm really happy to...
And we found out... Oh, sorry, I interrupted. We found out we made a really good team doing it.
Yeah,
so sorry, keep going.
No, you're good. So Jess and I met randomly at Mag Labs in 2017, I think. And then we found out that we live like half an hour from each other. So that worked out pretty nice. And yeah, so we've been working on VG lead sheets. We have a little VGM band called Full Combo. We like to cook for each other, and we went to Japan. So we've done a lot of stuff, and it was really nice to be able to make some music with her as well.
So if we go to the next slide, we'll talk about what we're going to do so that you can get a sense for what the panel's about. First thing we're going to do is we're going to see what a lead sheet's all about. If you went to David Piano's panel yesterday, where he did some transcription of a lead sheet, you might have an idea already, or maybe you just, you know, play lead sheets all the time anyway. But we're going to start from square one, tell you what a lead sheet's all about. We're going to go over what decisions have to happen when you make an arrangement. There are lots of decisions that you have to make and some that you can choose to make. We're also going to walk through an arrangement we've worked on together, like Maria was talking about, and then the audience participation comes at the end. We're going to create an arrangement together, or at least part of one, in real time with all of you. So be prepared.
It will be interesting, for sure.
It will be interesting.
The fewer the better, in my opinion.
Yes.
So what is a lead sheet? I'm curious in the audience, like how foreign of a concept is this for you guys? I know some of you I recognize from VG lead sheets, but does anybody here have just no idea what the heck we're talking about at all? Just kind of see where we're at with our audience. What is a lead sheet? Thank you, Jer. You understand what it is. Okay, well, good. So pretty much it is good. We seems like we have an audience who knows what we're talking about. So that's great. So, sounds poisonous. Lead sheet. Oh my God. So I think of it kind of like the recipe for a song, like the basic framework of it. It's not an exact transcription, so it doesn't have all of the lines. It just has some really, really basic framework of the song, so it's playable. So it's just the basic information in order to play the song. So it'll include your melody and your chords. It'll also have the form of the song. And then in terms of what else is in the lead sheet, it's a bit variable. I don't think there's like a standard across the world. It's kind of ad hoc a little bit. But we, at VG Lead Sheets, when we do our work there, we have like a set of guidelines that we've established. But a lot of times that's all there is. I mean, maybe there'll be like a tempo marker, but there's not much. But it's nice because since it's so bare bones, it's really easy to read and easy to communicate to other people. It's usually on a sheet of paper or two. So it's really, it really helps you play with other people, even people you've never met before or never played with before. So we can look at a lead sheet example. So this is Underwater from Super Mario Brothers. I think you guys probably know this one. It's that one that goes da 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 da. So let's look together at what this sheet is telling us. It tells us the name of the song. It tells us what game it's from. It tells us the tempo and the time signature. It tells us the melody, like what the actual notes are, the chords, and the form of the song. So in this case, it has a little intro, an A section, a B section, and then goes da capo back to the top. That's really all it gives us. Does that mean that that's the only thing you play is just that melody and just those block chords? No, but it kind of gives you a springboard to jump off from and create a jam or an arrangement. So as we said, it doesn't have everything. So things that it doesn't include would be which instruments are playing and when. In this case, this is a C sheet, so it's readable by C instruments. We make sheets, we have different transpositions for different instruments, but it doesn't say like this has to be done by violin or flute or whatever. It's just a general melody. It doesn't tell us the style or genre on this particular sheet. Some of our sheets do. We put a style marker. This one's like a waltz, so it's an old sheet, so we probably could put a style marker on this one. How we're going to end the piece. So if you're playing with other people, usually you'll have a little discussion beforehand about what you're going to do, how you're going to, if there's going to be solos, as you can see in the next point. And then you have to decide like how many times you're going to go through it. Where do you end? Sometimes you want to end like at the end of a section as opposed to the end of the song completely. So it doesn't tell us where to stop. It just says go back to the beginning. It doesn't tell us anything about dynamics, and it doesn't tell us any articulation. So that leaves a lot of things up for interpretation, which is neat when you're playing with other people. So we, you know, we talked about what it does give us, but you know, when you're doing an arrangement, you can just change it and do whatever you want. It doesn't really matter. So that's what we're going to show you, how we can do that and change all this stuff, you know, make it your own.
Yeah, so we came up with kind of a basic process that we went by when we were working on our arrangement together. So step one is to pick your song. So we're going to be doing Out of the Frying Pan, which is the one we did for the FF9 Materia album. Step two is you want to establish some goals for the arrangement. What are you trying to accomplish or convey with it? Step three, you want to pick your instrumentation, your style or genre. Sometimes that stuff gets decided for you, right? If you have a band and you're like, I want to arrange for my band, that's your instrumentation. Or if you're like, oh, I have a VGM orchestra that, you know, does stuff and you want to arrange for them, you have your instrumentation ready to go. And then the style or the genre can be totally up to you. You can also be really close to the original and try and get it exact, or you can take it somewhere totally different. Yep. Step four, and this, you know, steps one, two, and three kind of happen in your head a little bit as you go. But step four is where you really start to put stuff either on paper or, you know, paper or in a DAW or something like that. You want to create your overall roadmap or shape of the piece. So you can be like, all right, I want an intro, and then I want the main melody, the head, and then I want solos. You can kind of block it out from there. The way we did it was we thought about it with our group. Like, I play saxophone, Maria plays violin. We're like, all right, what parts do we want the saxophone to play? What parts do we want the violin to play? When do we want to give the guitar a chance to, you know, do anything ever? So that's the way we thought about breaking up the sections. Step five, start writing and see what comes out. And again, it can be in music notation or it can be in a DAW. It doesn't matter. We're going to use MuseScore today because that's what we're quickest with and what we're most comfortable with, but you can use whatever you're comfortable with or whatever is going to be good for your group. If you're writing for an orchestra, you're probably not gonna go straight to a DAW, but if you're writing for, you know, a smaller, tighter combo or something like that, you might use a DAW. It's up to whatever your purpose is and what's easy for you. And then step six, have an editor or just have someone else listen with fresh ears. We sent versions back and forth to each other a whole bunch, and it helps a lot just to have somebody else go like, oh, I'm getting really bored in this section, or, you know, something like that, or ah, this needs something else. It's really helpful. If you're Jer, you write it on a DAW. Yeah. Thanks, Bruno. Perfect. So some tips and tricks along the way. And this is kind of in the start writing piece, but it's good to have in the back of your mind as you're going. If you're writing in a certain style, create a playlist with a bunch of songs in that style so that you can find things that you want to mimic or steal. If you're trying to write in a new style, you might want to consider like what elements are intrinsic to that style. You know, if you're trying to write, like the thing we did was a jazz waltz and you've never listened to jazz waltzes before, you're going to want to make a playlist and decide like what makes something a jazz waltz. Another tip or trick is to vary the texture or the intensity by section. It helps it not get stale and not get boring. If you kind of use the same instrument over and over, or you're always kind of at the same dynamic level, the same texture, things get stale. So we want to switch it up. Have a big picture in mind going in. It's okay if the details change. If your arrangement changes 17 times between the time you like think of doing it and the time you give it to your group, that's totally fine. Completely allowed. And the last thing we were thinking about was maybe don't add or change so much that it no longer sounds like the tune you're covering, unless that's the idea, unless you're doing some like deconstructed Flintstones theme. I don't know, whatever you might be going for, but, you know, you can always take things away if you find yourself adding too much.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So back in this project started in early 2009, like right at the beginning of the year. They had announced that for the Materia Collective album, they were doing a Final Fantasy IX compilation album of arrangements. So that's one of my favorite OSTs, my favorite Final Fantasy. And so we had started doing some work with our band Full Combo, and you know, I thought it would be fun to do an arrangement for the band that we could use on the album. So I was at the time going through a bit of a jazz waltz phase. So I just had it in my bones that I wanted to write a jazz waltz arrangement. So I listened through the whole Final Fantasy IX soundtrack, and I found the song Out of the Frying Pan, and it just kind of popped into my head this new groove for it. So what I'll do is I will play you the original track, and then we can play a jazz waltz, that one that I really liked, that kind of summarized the style I wanted to go for. So this is the original. right. And then it loops from there. So yeah, that is the original song. And then I'm going to play, this is Vince Guaraldi Trio, Jitterbug Waltz. There's a few different versions of this one that I found that were good, but it's a fun piece. I really liked this version. And so it kind of was the one that inspired all of this. So I'll play a little bit of that for you. Yes, the original is not a waltz. That's correct. Lovely. I love that piece. It's so good. There's a bunch of them. One of the more famous ones you probably have heard of is My Favorite Things in a jazz waltz form. That one's pretty common. But yeah, that's the style. I think they're just so fun. They, you know, make you want to dance. Why? Okay, there we go. All right. Creating a roadmap.
Yeah. So I think, Maria, I think you came up with the idea. Like, I want a jazz waltz really bad. And so we went with the jazz waltz thing, and then we decided to like piece it out. Like, okay, how are we going to do it? And this is kind of a more detailed roadmap than you necessarily need to have. But this is kind of what we landed on as we went. I don't think we also had the whole thing laid out from right. the beginning, but we knew like, all right, we're going to do this slow rubato intro, like kind of classical ish before we flip the switch. So we'll do four bars of drums to kind of flip the switch and get into a new style. So you can see here, we've got the slow intro. We've got four bars of drums with a violin solo. We do the A melody. You know, if you look at the lead sheet, which we did, it's the melody from the, you know, the A section on sax. And then we harmonize the violin and the sax over the A melody. We got some neat piano arpeggio noodling in there over some new chords to change the texture, because if we tried to do the melody again, it was going to be kind of stale. Then we go to solos over the A section chords, and we decided that the B section, I always think this B section is really weird. I was like, all right, we gotta do something with this. We reharmonized it a little bit and we put it in the middle to keep it interesting. We've got a drum solo with some chord hits in there, some stabs, and then we take the head back out, the A melody back out, and layer some guitar and piano noodling over the top. So it definitely wasn't that detailed going in. We knew big picture, like, all right, slow intro, A melody, some solos, throw in B, and then A melody again to get out. So that's kind of what we were working with.
Yep. So this is just, so we had our Discord group for the band, and this is just all us going back and forth, like, oh, here's this file, and oh, here's this MP3 of it, and oh, we're going back and forth, and we just did this for weeks of, you know, one of us would add stuff to the arrangement, one of us would, you know, totally change it. So, you know, it was a lot of back and forth, also a lot of shenanigans. You'll notice that there is one username that pops up a lot with the shenanigans, Sigma Beta. but, you know, we have fun amongst it all. And then we also noticed that the guitar stems looked like spaceships. So we were saying how it's the Serenity. So, you know, make sure you're having some fun among all of the insanity. Okay, so we went through a bunch of different iterations. I thought I'd play for you our initial demo, which we sent for approval to be on the album. And then that section, I called it the D section. I forget what it actually was on the sheet, but where it just was weird. And then what we did to address it. So here's our initial demo, maybe.
Thank you.
that's the demo. So after we had submitted that, we added sections to the arrangement. There's that part in the original that goes dun 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 dun. You guys remember that? Dun 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 dun. So I was writing out the melody in this jazz waltz style, and I was struggling to make that sound even remotely interesting. So this is like what it initially sounded like, and then I'll show you what we did to it because it was just not doing it for us at all. So we go to 156. There we go. There we go. Anyway, so yep. So we didn't know what to do with that. So Jess just went all jazz on it and made it way better because I was completely stumped. I had no idea. So I'll show you how she changed that. So way better. There's more Flintstones. It's anyway. So that's yeah. So I'll play this next part because she added these stabs in as well, which wasn't in the last version. It was really jazzy and awesome. Anyway, so I will play for you the final product so you guys can hear. You know, there are a lot of steps in between that we cannot get to in our time, but you know, hopefully you can kind of infer what we did from lead sheet to the final product. Nope, that's not it. That's not it. Thank you. All right. So that's the final product. So we switched around how many times sections played. We added a solo section. We totally reharmed that weird, awkward section. Thank you very much, everybody. So it was fun. Like, it just kind of came together. Like, I don't know. It just kind of happened. I don't really have an exact way to say, like, make sure you do this, this, this. Like, we can tell you generally, but, you know, it just is somewhat of an organic process that you just have to start, and then it just occurs. I don't know. That was my experience anyway.
Yeah, totally. Like, you can go in with a plan, with a roadmap, and then, like, there's a lot of stuff that just happens. So, and we're actually going to get to show you how some of that works, because now we're going to try it together. This is the part where you do the audience participation, please. So, Maria's going to throw a poll into chat, and you are going to decide how we're going to do Megalovania. If you watch Storyoni Girl's stream, on the VGM Together, not VGM Together 2, she played an awesome rendition of Megalovania. We're going to keep going on the Megalovania kick here. Vote for if you want us to do it like a classical string quartet, like a New Orleans style-ish brass band, or like an a cappella choir. It's going to be ridiculous any of those ways. So go ahead and vote, please.
Do it. Do it. I'm fascinated by how these results are coming out.
I can't see them, so it's going to be a surprise to most of us here.
Y'all are brave.
So, I mean, a little bit of the secret is that we have a couple of templates ready to go with, like, the instruments already put in and, like, the intro melody already written out so that we can copy and paste, because that melody is, like, a bear to write out. So we stole it directly from the lead sheet. And we'll work through it together. Actually, I'm not sure if I can post links in chat. We'll see if this works, but this is...
I can if I'm a mod.
Cool. I tried to put the lead sheet that we're working off of so that everybody can see. Oh, thanks. Thank you to everybody who's voting right now. And this is going to be, I mean, a little bit like Twitch plays Pokemon, except we're going to arrange a thing. It'll be fun.
There you go.
Oh, thanks. Man,
this is fascinating. I don't know how many more votes we should get, but New Orleans Brass Band is winning by a long shot, and it's the one I was most worried about.
That's the one I'm most excited about.
Excellent. Fantastic. All right. I think that's... I think it's, like, overwhelming. It's 23 for that one, and then 5 for acapella, and then only 2 for classical string quartet. You guys, come on. No, that's fine. Oh, my God. Good. That's the one I wanted. I'm glad. Okay. All right. So let me pull up MuseScore.
Yeah. So if we're thinking New Orleans-style brass band, I mean, I'm thinking, like, second line. I'm thinking, like, Youngblood brass band. If anybody's familiar with things like that, what we've got, and Maria's got it up here, we've got instrumentation for, like, a trumpet, a tenor sax, a trombone, and a tuba. If you're not used to looking at transposing instruments, and you're, like, looking at the key signature and you're going, what now? Trumpet and tenor sax are both B-flat instruments, so they're going to be up a step. So it's going to be, like, an E minor for them, and it's in D minor as per the lead sheet for trombone and tuba. So as you can see, we've got, like, the melodies just, like, put in there real quick. Nothing like that has to stay. So, we can change literally everything about it if we want to. So let's see. I think we should start with something like the intro, right?
Yeah. Would you mind also explaining what makes up a New Orleans brass band for our audience? Like what about, obviously the instrumentation, but, like, what about the style? Like, what are we going for here?
Yeah. So, I mean, you can do a lot of things with this. But kind of the vibe I'm thinking is, like, kind of funk inspired, kind of march inspired. If you put, like, funk in a marching band, that's kind of what we're looking at.
Yeah.
So I wish I were better with writing out percussion notation. You can put some percussion in your head, because, like, there's definitely a lot of percussion that happens with a brass band, even though it's says brass band. But we're just
Yeah, exactly.
We've got, like, just under half an hour here to make something out of this.
Mm-hmm. Why don't we pick our tempo first? Well, it's a good. So this is at 80 now. So I'll show you what that's like. It's a little slow. What do you think?
Hey, you guys want to go faster or slower? Go ahead and throw it in chat here.
144. Whoa. Oh my God. Vetoed.
Sanic speed.
Sanic. Need some sweat. Yeah, we're working on that. Yeah. 98. Let's try 98.
Thank you, Nautilus Tea Party, for giving us a specific number.
I like that. What do you think? What do you think? Yeah?
Got it. Yeah, let's do it.
Okay. All right. So that's perfect. Excellent. I like it too. So let's put swing in and see what happens.
Yeah. So yeah, swing on the 16th.
Yeah, how do you swing it on the 16th?
It's a great question for somewhere in the settings menu.
Oops. Swing. That's all the
swing.
I don't know. That's something I was not expecting to add in, but that's fine.
Oh, thanks, Jer. Style option first window that's selected.
Style option first window that's selected.
I totally should have put this in the template because that's absolutely part of the style. You guys are right. So while Maria is finding that,
here we go.
Hey, there we go. While Maria's putting that on, how are we going to do the intro? Do you guys want to go into that intro melody right away, or do we want some chord hits? Can you tell us in chat, intro melody or chord hits?
Jeremy's format style.
All right, yeah. Oh, like Brooklyn. Yes, I love that tune. So we'll do some chord hits, and we will save that intro melody. Maybe we do like, one, E, one, and E, like that.
Do you mean like instead of the melody, like move the melody four bars forward, or in addition to the melody?
Yeah, move the melody four bars forward. We'll build up to it a little bit.
Okay.
We'll get some drama going with these chord hits. So in the lead sheet, if everybody's like looking at that lead sheet, we see we have a D minor chord first. So we're just going to like voice a D minor chord with our instruments. So like the tuba is probably going to take the root, as it should. And the tuba will get like, you know, D, 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 C, 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 B, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, all the drama.
Boop.
And kind of one of the good things about working Mu score like this, something that I think. I mean, I cheat a lot. I take the rhythm that I just did and I like copy and paste and then move it. Because writing out the rhythm can be a pain sometimes. So I just like copy and paste it and then shift the notes. It's like Maroon 5.
Is this the rhythm?
Yeah, maybe without the percussion.
Or am I just make sure?
Sorry, say it again.
Is that the rhythm you were wanting, or am I not understanding you?
The and of three and then the E of four.
Ah, the E of four.
I'm making your life complicated. I'm sorry. It's not cheating. It's efficiency.
Is that right? End of three and the E of four.
Yeah, and then right on one for the next bar. Oh, is that the A of four? It's real tiny on my screen.
Oh my God, I'm sorry.
No. And so what we'll do is we'll look at this, and we will like copy and paste this rhythm, or, you know, through the different instruments. So when I'm looking at my lead sheet, I see, okay, I have a D minor chord. My tuba probably wants the root. I might double that in my like soprano voice, so my trumpet. And then I'll give the third and the fifth to the saxophone and the trombone. They can take whichever.
Mm-hmm. Go here.
Yeah, I mean, we're just kind of like making up the pattern here, like one and E, yeah. One potato. Yeah, it'll be hip when it's done.
All right. This is fine for now.
Yeah. So maybe we steal that chord progression. We do the D, the C, the B flat. Awesome. And while Maria's working on that, what are we going to do with it next? So we've got these hits. How are we going to make it a little more dramatic for our next section? Do we want to go straight into the melody, or do we want to like pass fragments of the melody around the ensemble? I don't know. You can tell me either of those options, or if somebody in here has got a great idea, we can work with that too. Oh, what does the E and A stand for? Are we talking notes, or are they abbreviations for? Ooh, while Maria's doing that, let me go to my little board over here that I teach with. Let me erase stuff. Hold on. So I'm going to write it real big because I know it's real tiny for you guys. But basically, when you are counting and you've got four quarter notes, you keep your place in the bar by counting the beat, by counting the quarter notes. So like this would be one, this would be two, this would be three, and this would be four. Right? So like one, two, three, four, one, two, three, four. Just like that. When you want smaller notes, like faster notes, smaller subdivisions of your beat, you're going to add in like eighth notes, for example. So if you want this to go twice as fast, your numbers stay where they are because that's still the beat, but now we're just playing on the notes in between the beats. One and two and three and four and. You want to go even faster? Then you get to do like this, 16th notes. Right, you want to go twice as fast as that? We got our 16th notes. I'm getting a little cramped here, but that's as small as I'm going with my subdivisions. Right, these are called subdivisions because we're, you know, dividing the sub parts of the beat. And that takes the letters E and A. So it's messy, and I apologize, but that's one E and a, two E and a, three E and a, four E and a. I don't have to change my tempo to change how I count, right? One, two, three, four, or eighth notes, one and two and three and 16th notes, one E and a, two E and a, three E and a, four E and a. So the counts are all on the beat. And the other things that we were saying are like the in-between parts of the beat. So we're just picking out like which of those 16th notes are we going to play on. That's what we're doing.
All right. Let's see this.
Clearly, Walt Horner knows the pain of being a teacher. Yeah.
1, 2, 3, 4.
My measures are off. Sorry, guys. Ah, I see what I did. Sorry about that.
It's all good. While you're doing that, some questions in chat. Do I use standard more over Takadimi? I do, but I also teach middle and high school. I don't teach elementary. So I can see the value of Takadimi, but I use standard more. Absolutely, Bruno.
Okay.
Nice. Yeah, so Maria's got it kind of building up for us. So we've got just the tuba doing the first hits. And then we've got the tuba and the trombone doing the hits while the trumpet comes in with the melody. What do you guys think? We want to repeat the melody and repeat the melody in a different instrument, or do we want to change the texture? Tell me in chat. Repeat the melody on a different instrument or change the texture? So the texture is like, you know, are we doing hits still, or are we going to do something else? We got to shut it down, Maria. Doug says we've maxed out our Megalovania quota.
Oh.
Shut it all down. Ooh, I see a lot of texture. All right. So for texture, let's see. Maybe we can keep that melody going in the trumpet. I'm so sorry, trumpet players. You're going to have to do this without taking a breath. So we're just going to like copy and paste that trumpet melody again into the trumpet. And maybe the tuba keeps going with the like bump, bump, but up thing. And the trombone and the tenor sax go back and forth in eighth notes. They go from like either 5-3, 5-3, 5-3. And I'm talking scale degrees now. Or they go 3-1, 3-1, 3-1.
Okay, so we have.
Do it where each note is played by a different instrument. Do it Hockett style.
I don't know what note fits in the chord. But I'll just leave it at that for now.
Cool. Jay Sudo, that's 100% what class is like right now. It's great. Please show me all your dogs.
All right, so we're keeping the tuba, you said, for four bars.
Yeah.
Come on, zoom in. There we go. And we're keeping the trumpet. And then for the trombone and the tenor sax, are they going, you were saying threes and fives?
Yeah, just in eighth notes back and forth. So, like, for tenor sax, we can go, like, G, E, G, E, G, E, G, E for, like, the first bar. And then the next bar, you know, F sharp D, F sharp D, F sharp D.
Are you doing, okay.
Yeah, I'm transposing for you. So this is really great, everybody. Like, we've got kind of a direction to this, right? We're building up to something, and changing the texture like keeps it interesting. We're going to have to think about like how we're going to do the next section. Are we going to keep building this intro somehow, or are we going to go to our main melody? I feel like if, you know, as soon as we go to our main melody, we got to have some big change that's going to happen with our section. Sorry, I'm getting caught up on chat here.
It's okay.
Well, hoped. Thank you for figuring out what it would be in Takadimi. I don't know what it'd be.
All right. So is this what you're going for?
Yeah, exactly like that.
Okay.
And just like shift it down for the next couple chords.
The swing is a little bit weird with MuseScore right now.
That's all right. We've got the idea. Guys, Maria is really like carrying this right now. Can we like clap for Maria in the chat? Like, this is awesome. She's totally driving everything. You guys are great.
The swing is so weird.
So let's see. While we're fixing these two measures here, what are we going to do? Do you guys want to do another round of the intro? Or do you want to go to the A section melody? The ba-ba-da-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-da-da-da. What do you guys want to do? Intro or A melody, please? Listen to me use my teacher voice for that. Intro or A melody, please? All right. I see some A section coming up in chat. Awesome. You guys are doing a great job with this audience participation
thing. Yeah, it's great. This is so goofy.
Yeah.
This chord is throwing me for a loop here. See, this is the stuff Jess helps me with because my brain goes mostly by ear. So.
Which chord? The B minor 7 flat 5?
This major here.
Cool.
I feel like something's wrong. So, just an example of how you don't have to have a music theory degree to still be able to do this. Because I usually just figure it out eventually by brute force, which isn't ideal, but you can do it.
So tenor sax would want to go like between a C sharp and an E. And a trombone would want to go between a D and an F.
Like that? Are you talking about C sharp and C? Like if it were in C?
No, I'm speaking in the tenor sax key. Yeah.
Well. Oops.
Sorry, I thought I'm making life easy. I'm complicating everybody's lives here.
It's all right. What, we want to do the A section now? Because we only have a few minutes left. So.
Yeah, let's flip it over to the A section. So we've been going with the trumpet as the melody the whole time. And I'm so sorry, trumpet players, it is not all about you. So we're going to give the tenor sax the melody. Thank you very much. or the trombone, the melody. What do you guys think? Do you want the trombone or the tenor sax to have the melody at A? I'm starting a war in chat. Yeah, we can go that fast on a trombone if you're not me. I'm not a very good trombone player.
Play that fast? Yes, it can.
Yeah, it totally can.
I mean, I can move this to the trombone line so you can see what it sounds like. I kind of am into the whole trombone idea, but let's move it here so you guys can see. Oh, bring it down an octave.
Yeah, Tristan H. Music, get in here. Tell us how fast we can go. Danny, get in here. Tell us how fast we can go.
Hold my beer. Yeah, so do you guys want sax or do you want trombone? What do you say?
It's about half and half. Let's give it to the trombone.
Okay.
So, and then I see Nautilus Tea Party says, bring the rhythm from the stabs at the beginning. I like that idea. We'll keep that rhythm.
Doing. We read my mind. Like this?
Yeah.
Read my mind.
I feel like we need to like complicate it somehow. Like we have to add like another layer of interest, right? We got to keep that texture, keeping it interesting. So if we've got but, we could go like 20 and E and a. I'm going to make your life difficult if I do E and a.
I have some ideas of just random stuff. Let's see. Oops.
Is it not hip to make fun of trombone play trombone anymore? I mean, I feel like trombone players take care of that themselves. Hey! I'm kidding. I love you, trombone players. Yeah, so we can just
figuring out what's seeing what sticks.
Exactly, Wild Horner. Exactly, Tristan. How many first trumpets does it take to change a light bulb?
Oh my god.
I mean, one to do it and three to say how much better they could have done it. Yeah, there it is. There it is. Sorry, I might be late. Ooh, nice. How many second trumpets? There it is. There it is, Eric. So keeping the stabs and the tuba, and then adding like kind of a counter melody kind of texture.
Mm-hmm.
So Maria, we have 5 minutes left. Do we want to like play it from the top and then take questions?
Sure. There's some gaps, but, and there's some wrong notes, but this is, you just try to like, when I do this stuff, I just like spit out stuff. See what it looks like. There's going to be errors in it, and then you go back and you fix it. But like, I know personally, I have a hard time getting everything from my brain onto the page, so I try to just get as much out as possible, and then I go back. I don't know if you do that, Jess.
Oh yeah, totally. Totally. I take breaks and I come back to it, and I'm like, oh yeah, now I know how to work this.
And while you want to like make it perfect from the get go, it's just like it's you'll just be never finish the song really. Imagine parade down the street of Megalovania. I will go from here. And you can add more counter melody in there. But yeah, I mean, we're just winging it, making it up. But thank you, Seth. yeah, the swing is all over the place. MuseScore is a little finicky with it. So, you know, if you're doing this in a DAW, you could fine tune it a little bit better. But for the purposes, I think you guys get the idea. For the purposes of this impromptu arrangement, I think it's good enough. But yeah, let's open it up to some questions.
I mean, I'm also loving the jokes coming through, Dylan. That's great. Let's see. Oh, a little further back. Not OST Party says, do you ever record voice memos while you have an idea in your head?
Ooh.
Is that something you do?
No. Do you?
Not usually. I
should.
Like,
that's a good idea.
That's a great idea. I like sketch it out on, you know, usually it's like a rhythmic thing, or I'll just write down, oh, the scale on beat four. Like I'll write it out in words, but that's a much better idea.
Yeah, there's a parameters tab. Oh yeah. Well, that's fine for now. Anyway, yeah, so that's a good idea. I usually write them down on a sticky note, which is like totally weird. I don't know why I do that. What do you write an outline usually, like on paper, or is that just me being old?
I mean, if I'm like preparing a presentation, certainly, but like no, if I'm doing an arrangement, usually it's usually I'm working it out in MuseScore. Like I'll kind of lay out, like, you know, just like you saw in the presentation, like, okay, slow intro, rubato, then a melody, like I'll write it out and I'll leave myself that number of bars in MuseScore, and you can input text into MuseScore so you can write to yourself as you do it. That's kind of how I think about it, as I think about it, like by section, like, okay, A section, that's my intro or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Any advice for how to sort out transpositions for those who don't know how it works? Yes.
Please, so there's take all the advice I can get on this. I'm so ingrained in C, it's not even funny.
Number one, learn the saxophones because they're the best, and then you get the transpositions for free. But number two, what you can do, there's a little button in MuseScore that's like concert pitch up at the top.
Should have
it's in that top bar.
There it is.
It's funny because like I can't write in concert pitch because I'm like, I want to know what range I'm playing and like, is this high for my saxophone? But you can toggle on and off concert pitch, and then you can like look at it later and you can see, oh, no, that I wrote it too high for the range. But, you know, that's one way to do it, is to do that. Also, you can stick with like the trumpet and the tenor sax because those are only one step away, as opposed to like alto sax, or I'm sorry, French horns. I always go the wrong way with the fourths and the fifths when I try to transpose for you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Jess is the transposition queen at VG Lead Sheets. For
sure. If something doesn't look right on a VG Lead Sheet, let me know and I'll fix it, because that's my mistake in
the
transposition.
The only one I can read is viola, the alto clef, and that's the only other one. I feel like it's hard if you don't play the instrument, but I don't know.
Yeah. Yeah, it gets easier if you play the actual instrument. So I'm sorry, I apologize. I think we have to cut our questions here because that's going to be the end of our time. Thank you very much for coming. Thank you very much for the participation. You guys have been awesome about doing this together. Yeah, Maria, anything else?
One more thing. I wanted to show them our David Pumpkins any questions slide. It's really important.
Yes, please.
Any questions? No, we already asked for our questions, but thank you for hanging out with us and and dealing with my struggles with MuseScore. I mean, that's just the baseline when you use it, but it's free, so there's that.
Maria's a hero for doing this.
Oh, I try. Thank you. But yeah, I think that's it for us. We'll be back tomorrow talking about getting into VGM as a budding musician. So if you have any new musician friends, or if you're a new musician, or if you're playing a new instrument that you've never played before and you want to get into video game music, stop by tomorrow because we're going to be talking all about that. Yeah, this is your brain on MuseScore, exactly. All right, well, I guess that'll do it. Anything else from Jess?
That's it. Thanks, everybody. Right. Goodbye.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.